Fred's shop. My name is Fred Esker. Last October, Woodcraft sponsored a video showing how to carve a spoon using a spoon mule. So today, we're actually going to show you how to make the spoon mule. In the video down below, you'll see a list of all the tools and a description of all the material that we're using. I'm making an assumption that a lot of people don't have power tools, so I'm going to concentrate on using hand tools here. Obviously, people with power tools can use them, and the job will go a little bit faster. So you see we've got laid out here 3 2x6s, 8 feet long. There's a board here that we're going to use for the clamping legs, and a relatively wide board. This is a 2x10 that we'll use for the seat. See, in addition to the wood, we've got 2 3/8 inch by 8 inch carriage bolts, and we've got 2 5 inch carriage bolts. And we have a box of 3-inch drywall screws here. To start our build, we're gonna work on the bench first. My bench is 4 feet long, and the reason for that is the lumber that I had was 8 feet long, and I just cut the 2x6 in half, and that seemed like a reasonable length to me, and it worked out fine for my first mule that I built. To determine the height of the mule, I literally stacked up boards and sat on them so that my legs were parallel to the floor. I'm 6'1", so if you look at the legs here, that's how I determine the length and the height of the bench. If you're shorter, you may want to trim that down, but I'll show you how to do that later. We're going to start out with these dimensions, and then you can adjust the height later, and I'll show you how to do that. First step is to cut our 2x6 in half. I'm going to cut it off here at 8 feet and at 4 feet. Nothing precise about this. It's just framework for the bench. Now, if you're a fan of Roy Underhill, you've heard him say when you're using a saw, there's an easy way to make sure you get a square cut both this direction and across the board. And that's by looking at the reflection of the saw in the board. So if this lines up with the reflection of the saw, you know you've got your saw square in both directions. So the next piece we need is this spacer board in here. It's just 5.5 inches long, same width as the 2x6. Measure twice and cut 5.5 inches. So we have our 2 4-foot 2x6s. We're going to fasten this spacer in the front so it's lined up with the front edge of the boards and top to bottom. I'm going to put a spacer back here just to hold this up. And now I'm going to put 2 3-inch screws in here just to hold this in place temporarily. They don't do anything for the structure of the mule, but just to hold this spacer in place while we put those bolts in. And then the same thing on the other side. Check my alignment, make sure I got everything straight. Okay, next let's move to the back leg. We need a 21-inch 2x4, so we're back to the handsaw and using our next 2x6 to cut off the back leg. If you see what I've done with 21-inch 2x6, I've got it flush with the top of the bench right here, and I've got it flush here on the back side. I'm going to draw lines there then, and I'll know where I have to cut that board. So the angle I'm going to use to splay this out to make the bench more stable is a 1 in 4. So what I did with my bevel gauge is set it at one inch here and 4 inches here. And then if I come back here, I can check that angle. That's about the right angle. That angle is totally arbitrary. If you want to splay that out farther, you certainly can. I don't like a straight up and down leg because the bench gets a little bit wobbly on you. So now what we're going to do is mark our 2x6. What you do with the bottom of the leg is totally up to you. On the bench I made here, you can see I kind of kept about a 3 or 3.5 inch width and just made a gentle arc. That's my starting point, and we'll go from there. If you want to cut the bottom of the leg off flush, you can use your bevel gauge and do the same thing. So if I mark this like this, that line is parallel with this line. So if the bench is parallel with the floor, that should sit on the floor properly. So I'm going to go from the corner of the 2x6 here to the corner of the bench 2x6, and we'll draw a line there, and then we'll measure from that line 3 inches. So we'll scribe this line at 3 inches. And again, this is aesthetics. If you want to leave the board the total 5.5 inches, certainly do that. I just think this looks a little nicer. That angle that I drew on here, I want to go from that corner, and I'm going to draw that. So now we have this part of the leg is going to be clamped inside the two boards we cut for the bench rails. And right here is the bottom of that, somewhere in here. And then this is what's going to stick down below. As I'm looking at this, I'm going to change my mind. The bench rail is going to sit right here. And I was planning on making this 3 inches from here to here and then keep the 3 inches all the way down to the bottom. But I can make this leg stronger by leaving this on there. So I'm going to redraw this line and go from this point down to the bottom of the leg to leave a little bit more meat on the leg right here. So with our leg cut now, we can put this back in place, get it lined up again. And what I'm going to do now is clamp that in place so I don't get any movement when I'm drilling holes for the bolts. So you've got 4.5 inches of material to drill through here. So I'm going to use this lamp bit, but I believe a spade bit will still go through this 4.5 inches. Normally I would use some kind of device to make sure I'm being perpendicular and square with the wood. So I think I can get through here and still catch enough meat top and bottom to drill this. So that's the back leg finished. Front legs are a little more difficult. So now we're back on the front end of the mule. You can see this is that spacer we put in for the front legs. So our job now is to fit legs on the front similar to the back in that they're going to extend out toward the front of the mule. But in addition to that, you see they splay out to the side. So there's a compound angle in here that has to be cut to make them do that. So our next job then is to cut the 21 inches that we need for the leg. And then we'll have to lay out this design on those legs. The other issue you've got is a normal spade bit won't go through 7.5 inches of material. I deliberately cut this part of the leg to be 1.5 inches thick, so an 8-inch bolt would work in here. There is a way that I can show you that'll help you use a normal spade bit. But again, I've got that big lamp bit, so I'm going to be able to go all the way through this, clamp it in place, and drill all the way through it. So now we're going to cut off the two 21-inch front legs. I've laid out the leg, and I'm going to hold this up here so you can get oriented as to how it's going to fit on the mule. This is going to fit underneath the rail of the bench. It's about 1.5 inches. This fits along the side of the bench rail. This is going to be outside of the bench rail, and this is what the bolt is going to go through to hold the two legs together to the rail. So I've cut this off to make it flush with the top. This is just an arbitrary angle depending on how you want your leg to look later on. And you can see way down here on the bottom, I've cut the leg off so it sits on the floor flat. Now I'm going to show you how I laid all that out. So the first thing I did was laid out a line 1.5 inches from this edge. And I just used my square. I know that is 1.5 inches thick. Drew me a line there. Next thing is using that same 1-in-4 angle that we used on the back leg. Now this is where you have to make sure you've got a square cut on the end of this board. But again, we're not making furniture, so if you're off a little bit, it doesn't matter either. Remember, from here to here sits on the edge of the bench, on the side of the bench. So that has to be 5.5 inches long. So I've laid my bevel on there, and I slid the bevel until I had 5.5 inches along that line. I know it's hard to see. See, 5.5 inches is right here. So you can slide your bevel back and forth like this until this line is 5.5 inches from the 1.5 inch line there up to the edge of the board. Next thing that I did is I want 1.5 inches of material on the outside of the bench because I've got three layers of 1.5 inches because I put the spacer in between the two 2x6s, and I have 1.5 inches here and 1.5 inches from the other leg. That all adds up to 7.5 inches, and that makes an 8-inch bolt, 8-inch carriage bolt work to go through all of that. That's the same 1-in-4 angle that I used to cut that so it's flush with the top of the bench. Where the 5.5 inches met down here, I use that angle also. Draw that line. So all of this gets cut out. This gets cut off. All of this gets cut off. And way down here at the back end, at the bottom, we're gonna cut all of this off, again, to make the leg sit flat on the floor. Now, for purposes of the demonstration, again, I'm not gonna cut any of this leg out. It's gonna look big and blocky and clunky and stuff. And again, you can do what you want with that leg, any kind of design you want. But I'm just gonna do this for now. Now, after I cut this out, the next leg is gonna be very easy in that you just have to lay this down on the other 21-inch 2x6 that we cut out and trace around that and cut it out. So that's how the leg, the front leg will fit. But one thing I want to point out to you is we did not cut that compound angle there. Remember, we want this leg to splay out like this. So after I lay out the other front leg, I'll show you how to cut that angle. In order to facilitate that, I also want to mark these legs. So as I'm looking at this, this is the left leg and this is the front of the left leg. I'm going to mark the other one in front of the right leg to make sure that I cut this properly. So now that we have one leg cut out, the job gets a little bit easier. Make sure we've got the edges lined up properly and scribe our lines. I guess I should have pointed out to you that I am cheating. I'm not cutting all this with a handsaw. I've used a bandsaw to cut some of these things out. Here are our two front legs. So they'll fit on the mule like this. We have to splay these legs out forward like this. So to do that, we have to remove material off this space, that material, to get it to be able to lean forward. And I know how much material there because I can use my bevel gauge, same angle that we had, draw that line, and then cut it straight across here. And that'll remove that material to allow this to splay forward. And we'll do the same thing on the other side. So again, I talked about marking these. This is the side I want to remove material from. So I'm going to call this the front, and this is the right-hand side as I'm looking at it. So I know I have to remove material there. So I'll scribe this line. I'm going to eyeball this. It has to be parallel with this edge. So I'm going to draw that there. And then again, this is the material that we're going to be removing. And on this side, no material there, but remove this wedge. And I'll have to do that with a handsaw because I don't want to change the angle on my bandsaw. I don't know the angle anyway because I'm using the 1:4 ratio. To cut this little wedge out, I'm going to use a pole saw, also called a flush cut saw, available at your local woodcraft store. This one happens to have two sets of teeth. You can see on the side closest to you is a finer set. And in a more coarse set here. Very handy saw for certain applications. So I'm gonna cut down here, laying the saw flush against the face there. I'm gonna cut down here to the line and to the edge of the wood up there. Turn around here, and this is a little bit tricky. So you're gonna have to pay attention to how you got this lined up. And there we go. And then we'll do the same thing on the other side. So the two legs then are gonna fit like this. So the second leg that I cut, you see I didn't quite get on the line here. It got a little bit of a gap here. Here's a different look at it. You see I missed the line a little bit there. There's a bit of a shoulder all in here that didn't get cut properly. I'll just use my shoulder plane and clean that up a little bit, see if I can get a little bit tighter fit on that. The other thing is I've got grain running this way. If I tried planing in this direction, I'd be going against the grain and it wouldn't cut. Going this way kind of combs the grain down. I'll just keep nibbling away at it till I get down to the line there and try to make a nice smooth surface there for us to ride on. All right, I'm gonna hit it a couple licks right here too. See if I can get a nice square edge in there. So we've got the front legs clamped in place here now, and you can see they're splayed side to side, and we've got them leaning forward. One advantage of having a three-legged stool, I've seen these made with four legs also, but a three-legged stool will always sit on a surface. You don't have to have a flat surface for it to sit on.
It'll never wobble for you.
I'm going to say that you're not going to be able to clamp this in place with one person. You're probably going to need an extra pair of hands to hold the legs in place and somebody else to fasten the clamp on there. And as far as positioning of the legs, I try to get the legs somewhere in the middle of this spacer that we cut here. But it's really not critical where you put it. You can move them out here. You can move them back farther. It really doesn't matter. As long as you can get the bolt that's going to go through the legs and through all of this. So after you have the legs in place where you want them, I'm going to draw some reference lines on the bench part of this to make sure I get them right back in the same place. Because as we're drilling holes through here, you're going to want to be able to find that same place back. So now our job is to bolt the two legs on. We're going to have to drill through 7.5 inches of material. We could do that with this long bit, or I think most people have spade bits that you're going to have to use instead of having that long bit. So I'm going to show you how I would drill through 7.5 inches of material with basically a 5-inch bit. We've got our lines marked here. We know where the leg is going to go. So I'm going to drill all the way through these three layers of 2x6s and then use those for pilot holes. I'm going to go about 1 inch from each edge. To keep things vertical, I'm going to put my tri-square up here, and I can line up with that, and then I'll eyeball it in the other direction and make sure I'm staying pretty much straight up and down. And one more time. So now the job is to continue those holes through the legs. Now I'm going to line the leg up with those lines that we put on there previously. So I've got the leg clamped in place. These are the holes that I drilled earlier. So all I'm going to do now is mark the leg where the holes need to go. And now I can take this off and drill those holes all the way through. All right, that's that side, and we'll do the same thing on the, for the other leg now. Using those parallel clamps, I had a little bit of trouble getting access to the holes to drill, so I switched here to an F clamp to give me a little more room. So we'll turn it over, and again, all we're gonna be able to do is mark the leg, and then we'll take it off and drill them all the way through. Obviously, the best way to do this is just to get a long bit, which are available from Woodcraft. You can buy a 10-inch brad point bit from them. So now, let's see how we did. We'll clamp it all together and see if we can get the bolts through there. And that's the bench. Again, it's three-legged, so you don't have to worry about the floor being level. It won't pop with that. Feels good and solid to me. One thing that you might want to pay attention to is some of these edges. On the bandsaw, you can round these edges off. You can hit these with a rasp or a plane and knock these sharp edges off. I'm gonna do that later on, but sometimes it's easier to do while you're cutting the legs out. And again, these legs are real blocky looking. They'll be a little bit lighter if you trim some of this wood out of them. So you can shape them and do what you want with the front legs. This is the seat that I put together for my original bench. See, it's just a 2x6, and I had a 2x12 treated board laying around, so I just cut a piece of it off and used it. Nothing fancy. Took a plane and rasp and rounded the edges off to save my backside a little bit from sitting on it. And it fits in between the two 2x6s. You notice that it does not, it's not fastened down. You want this to be able to slide so that you can move yourself in relation to the head so that you have different angles of attack with your workpiece. So this is what we're going to put together now. If this is just 5.5 inches, the same as the width of the 2x6 on the bench, and this is about 16 inches wide. My behind isn't quite that wide, but you can make it to suit yourself. What I've been toying with is trying to find an old steel tractor seat to put on here to give the bench a little more character. You can make pads for these things, really do anything you want with them. First thing I'm gonna do is cut off the 5.5 inches off the 2x6 for the part that sticks down between the two rails of the bench. So 5.5, 6 inches, it really doesn't matter what you cut off here. So So a bench with square corners here is gonna be pretty uncomfortable for you. This is an 11 inch circle. You can scoop this out like a Windsor chair would be. Now to fasten the 2x6 onto the seat, I'm gonna find a center line here. I'm gonna stick my 2x6 on here. I'll eyeball it. I've got the 2x6 clamped onto the seat right where I want it. So I'm gonna put a couple screws in here to hold it in place. And that's our seat. Take a rasp in a plane and knock these edges off and make that more comfortable for you. So now we're on to making the head. The head is only four boards. You can see there's a center stem here that is 18 inches long. We're gonna use the two by sixes, one on each side of that, that are 8 inches long. And you have the top board, which I made 13 inches long. I think with some design changes that I wanna make it 11 and a half. The reason for that is I cut this divot out of there so that the spoon would sit flat and I'd be able to work on the handle, but it really doesn't give me enough room to work there. I'd like to move this up here an inch and a half farther. That means that I got about an inch and a half here that I really don't need anymore. I made the top out of a 2x8, so I think I'm just gonna use a 2x10 for the top also. So I've got a 2 inches here up to the slot. The slot itself is 3.5 inches wide by an inch and a half deep. The slot also on the bottom down here is beveled so that when these clamp boards go in there, you see they're at an angle and they need room over here to be able to flex. And that's also why instead of putting a rigid rod through here to hold these in place, we use a flexible wire that'll hold these in place. When you move this, it's got some room. The pivot point here will flex a little bit. The other thing I made, one of the reasons this is 3.5 inches is that if I wanted to work on something that was thicker, I can get a board in here that's a little bit over an inch wide. If I'm working on a spoon like this, that is too much because you see I'm spread way out here to hold that. So one of the things I made for that are some spacers. They're just a plain wood or about 3/8 inch thick that I can stick in here. Then I have more latitude in how big a piece of work I can put in clamps. First thing we'll do then is we'll cut the 2x6s. We need 2/8, 1/18, and then we need a 11.5 inch 2x10 cut off. All we're gonna do is put three or four screws in here, three or four screws on the other side to hold this all together. That's our center post, and we're gonna put our work platform right on top of there. This is gonna be our top work platform. This slot is 2 inches from the edge. It's 1.5 inches deep, and it's 3.5 inches side by side. And I wanna center that. 4.5 inch center, and I wanna go 1.75 inches on each side of that. There's that, and 3.5. So this is the slot that I want to cut out. That is 4 inches. I'd like to make this area maybe 2.5 inches. So we've got 2.5 there. The opening at the bottom is 1.5 inches. So we need the center again, which is 4.5 inches. So we want 3/4 inch on each side of that. There's nothing magical about these dimensions either. It's gonna be more or less what's comfortable for you, the types of spoons you make and so on. I can cut this out on a bandsaw. This I'm going to drill and finish it up with a chisel. So you can see I've drilled some pilot holes to get me started. I've got my coping saw set up, blade stuff through there. Now it's just a matter of hacking all that out of there. So here's where we are so far. The slot in the back that I cut with a bandsaw. This is the slot that the clamping sticks will go in. And as I said earlier, on the back side, we have to cut these at an angle so that the clamping sticks have some room to work on both sides. And I have a little flush cut saw that I like a lot, actually. I'm just gonna cut across the fibers here and start making that slope. I'm going almost all the way through, maybe 1/4 inch or so from the top surface. and I'm coming back here about an inch or so. This might be something that you have to kind of play with, put the sticks in there and see if you have enough room and so on. So now I've got a 3/4 inch bench chisel. We'll just hog this stuff out of here. I don't care if it cracks and splinters until I get down to the end anyway. Then I'm gonna be a little less aggressive with it. We'll start with that anyway, and we'll try the sticks in there and see if they have enough room to work. Now the other side, kind of eyeball it here and see if I'm getting somewhere close to the same slope on it. Looks pretty close. Yeah, I see one other thing I want to clean up a little bit, and that's some of my jigsaw marks and drill marks in here aren't very nice. That looks a little better to me. Our next step was going to be to mount this on the head, but that's not the case because I forgot we have to drill these holes in here. So I have to mark these holes and then go back over to the drill press. What I made for an axle for the clamp boards was a clothes hanger. I twisted it up to give it a little bit more rigidity so it fits through the work platform on the head. So I'm drilling a 1/4 inch hole through both sides here for that to go all the way through. So the next step to be able to locate this wire is to find the center of this slot, which is at 2 3/4 inches. And the board is 1.5 inches thick, so we want center of that is going to be 3/4 inch. So we're going to drill a 1/4 inch hole right there. And do the same thing on the other side. So now we're ready to mount the work surface onto the pedestal. It's a real easy alignment because you see this center post here lines up with the slot we cut. So all we really have to do is decide where you want it back and forth. You want to make sure that the pedestal here doesn't cover any of this hole. But other than that, you're free to mount it about anywhere you want. So I'm gonna put it somewhere close to the middle and just kind of eyeball it and screw it down. Remember, you're gonna round these surfaces off, so you don't want the screws to be real close to the edge over here. I might be able to cheat a little bit more this way to give me more room to round this out. Hollow that out. One of the things that I didn't show you on the head was this hole. You put your head down and drive a wedge in there, it locks the head in place. So it gives you a much more sturdy work platform. So we still have to do that on our new head. To locate that, I put the head in here, drew a line across the bottom of the bench, which is this line. Now we're going to locate a 1-inch hole in the center this way and 1/4 inch below that line at the bottom of the bench. That will leave 1/4 inch above the line, 3/4 inch below, and it will allow the wedge to lock the head onto the bench. So we're back to the drill press. We will drill that hole. So these are our two clamp sticks. And you see they're 3/4 inch thick, 1 1/4 inches wide. And the length of them I determine by setting them up here and cutting them 4 or 5 inches longer than the top of the deck, the top of the work surface. And I'll show you the reason for that. So let's put them in place. And you'll see that I've got them up against the bench down here, and I'm going to hold them out to the edges of the slot that I cut for them. Then I'm going to take 1.5 inches, which my ruler just happens to be, and I'm going to mark these there, and that's going to be the final length of the sticks. That allows you to push the sticks out if you have smaller material in here. It allows you to use, you could have material in here as thick as 1.5 inches even and hold it like that. Now this is going to be a personal preference thing also. If you want them shorter, they feel more comfortable to you. If you don't want them dragging on the floor, you can resize these, cut them as short or as long as you want. But it's kind of a personal preference thing. I'm just showing you how I've done it. Okay, now we don't want this angle there, so I'm going to lay this flat on my work surface, and I am going to
draw a line here. And I'm going to do the same thing here. Because when they come together, all they have to do is hold the wood. I want to cut that little sliver off and cut the length off here and here and cut that out. Next step after that, then, we have to hold these against the sides again and put a marker, put an awl through that hole that we drilled here and here and mark where we're going to drill the hole for these. So I put our sticks back in. And they're in the same position. They're touching the bench here. I got them up against the edge of the slot. I'm going to take my awl, center this in the slot this way. Take my awl, give it a punch. That's where I want to drill my holes now for the clothes hanger to go through for the hinge point. And also you'll notice that they are at an angle, and I'm not going to measure that angle, but I will hold the drill bit at an angle to drill through there. Will not drill through at a perpendicular. Okay, so to drill this again, I'm not going to worry about measuring the angle, because as the sticks clamp different thickness of material, the angle changes all the time anyway. So if you're anywhere close, you're going to be okay yet. Plus, there's a lot of play between the hole and the clothes hanger that we've got in there, so they fit in there a little bit loose. So it's not a critical measurement. And you can see this hole is not in the same place either. I didn't get the holes that I drilled through here correct. But again, that's not a critical point. It's not going to affect the functioning of the mule. So now we have our two clamp sticks. We have the holes drilled in to receive the wire. So I'm going to feed that through that quarter inch hole we drilled through the head. Through one stick, through two sticks. So here's our clamp sticks now, and you can see there's a bit of play in them. They're loose, and that's why that wire is flexible. That's why that angle didn't matter. As the sticks come out, they have some room to move. We've got a functional mule right now, but we still have a couple little things we need to work on. Remember now, if they're all the way out here, we size this for about an inch and a half piece of work. If we were going to clamp this spoon in here, we're gonna have to use these little spacers, and they'll fit right in here. That way the legs or the clamping sticks don't have to be pushed out as far to hold that in place. Let's talk about these spacers. Inch and a quarter by 2.5, 5/16 inch thick, 1/4 inch thick stock, 3/8. You can make them any thickness you want, depending on the thickness of the workpiece. They really don't have to be any wider than these clamp sticks, which are 1¼. This slot here just has to go past the wire. So that slot is 1¾ by about 7/16. So the very last piece we have to make is the wedge that holds the head in place. We drilled this hole down here for this wedge to fit in. It wedges against the bottom of the bench, holds it solid so you can work against it. So what I made here is a 7-inch wedge. It's made out of a 3/4 inch stock, and this I made out of poplar also, not pine, because I think the pine will get beat up pretty fast as you hammer it in that hole. The narrow end is 1/2 inch thick. The thicker end is 1¼. Now I'm going to tell you that's a rough dimension right now, and you may have to do some trimming. You may have to shave 1/16 inch off it or so. Because what you want it to go in this hole, but you also want it to stick out the other side slightly so you can hammer the wedge out. You don't want to just hammer it in and then have to grab it and shake it to open it up. Lastly, you notice I spent zero time cleaning up edges, rounding things off. That's what I would recommend you do now, is get your rasp out and your chisel, get your little block plane out, and round off all these edges. And don't forget, you need to rasp this out quite a bit, because you want a big pocket here, again, for that spoon to fit down in here. And you want to rasp this out. These sharp edges will put nicks in your workpieces. I would also recommend rounding these corners off and sloping this down. You can compare the two. You see how I've really beveled this down. And a lot of that work was done with the chisel. You have sharp edges here and here, possibly even up here, depending on how big a workpiece you have. You need to round these off on both sides and make this very smooth from the first one. And the reason for that is when you clamp a piece of wood, especially some softer wood like basswood, you're going to put dents in the wood. Because really the only thing you need for clamping is just one spot in the center. Down here on the bottom, they're going to hurt your feet if you don't smooth some edges out on these things. Other than that, you might want to do some work on your seat. Some of this lumber was pretty rough and it's got splinters and stuff in it. Sand that kind of stuff off and make sure you don't injure yourself while you're handling it. I think that's all. I enjoyed the demonstration and I hope you all have fun making your own spoon mule.